Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our Rock and Redeemer. Amen. Good morning, church. Warmest greetings to all of you, whether you are on site or you are online. What is today? Today is the 8th day of Chinese New Year. So how has your Chinese New Year been getting on? Have you been eating and eating, meeting and meeting? Yes? Now, whether it was a pandemic or not, we can find ways and means to celebrate the Chinese New Year, right? Do you know that over 2 billion people celebrate Chinese New Year every year? And that is about a quarter of the whole world population. Imagine the number of gatherings happening in the world at the same time. And do you know how much calories you have been eating by popping in those little pastries into your mouth each time? Well, I've done some research, okay? The conclusion is that each pineapple tart, right, it contains on average 93 calories. And one love letter has 56 calories. So how many of us would stop at one? All right, I shall not spoil your mood, okay? But really what bothers, right? Is that it just didn't bother us at all. We just eat and eat whatever that comes. Because we just want to treasure that time together, as we gather together with our friends, with our families. That is the time that we want to treasure, the get-together. Perhaps, let's change the subject. Let's change the topic, okay? Not on Chinese New Year anymore. Do you know the difference between a boomer and a Gen Z? How many boomers we have here? How many Gen Zs do we have here? So for one, while the boomer went through the entire period of technological evolution and the rise and development of the media, and of course the boomers are less dependent on smartphones then, perhaps not now, but part of the DNA of a Gen Z is the internet. So for a boomer and a Gen Z, how do they communicate with each other when they sit next to each other? Or how about this? Do you know that Switzerland is facing temperatures so high that operations at many ski resorts have been disrupted? Patches of grass are seen on the supposedly snowy slopes. Artificial snow have been laid to create the semblance of winter for the skiers. Now, friends, climate change, global warming, they are so remote to us, right? But we must realize that our livelihoods, our communities are being threatened with the increasing destructive disasters. So, friends, all these questions, do you know? Do you notice something common in them? Do you notice something common in them? Yes, it's our getting together, our gathering, our community. It is there everywhere in the world. What does it mean to gather together? Well, gather together. It means coming together to form a group, to meet together as a group in one place. And so, the next question, then why do we need to gather? Perhaps it is just for fun, to share about life, to encourage one another, to listen to one another, to be present, just simply to be there for one another. So on a social setting, what do the men usually talk about? Hey guys, football, watches perhaps, and what do we have? F1. Now, for women, what do we talk about in a social setting when we get together? We talk about family, my children, in general, right? Do you have this cooking recipe? Can you share with me? See, the truth is that there are such gatherings, but our frequent response is, I don't have time. I can't meet. My plates are full. I'll think about it tomorrow, but tomorrow never comes. because we are always living in today. Someone else will do that organization. Let's just wait. And we keep silent because it's none of my business. So life goes on and on. And we say that it is all about priority. Perhaps it is also because it is out of our comfort zone. Can I just stay by myself alone? Leave me alone. Well, the Bible does have examples of God meeting people who are alone. For example, Hagar, Jacob, Moses in the desert, Elijah in the wilderness, just to name a few. So the question is really, is it necessary to gather together? Friends, my answer to you this morning is yes. It is necessary to gather together. In fact, not only do we gather together, whether as a congregation now in a worship service or in our cell groups, we gather together in Christ since we know what Jesus had done for us. And that is our confidence in Christ. Today's passage in Hebrews 10, verses 19 to 20 tells us this, and let me repeat these verses. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh. Now, by the blood of Jesus, through his flesh, what did Jesus do for us? Number one, Jesus is the perfect sacrifice. That's why we have confidence in him. How do we know? The shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ is seen. It is seen as a representation of the giving of his life as an atoning sacrifice for the sins of humanity. Now, Romans 5:8 tells us this. God shows his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And a very familiar verse that all of us know of, John 3:16, clearly shows that God loved the world so much that he gave us his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So friends, this is the love of God. This is love beyond reason. And this is what we can have confidence in God. And secondly, through the crucifixion of Jesus, he opened a new and living way that he opened for us through the veil, through the curtain, that is, through his flesh. So what is this veil, what is this curtain about? Now, may I invite all of us to imagine this with me. In the old Jewish conception, the veil, it hangs before the heavenly sanctuary and it expresses the hiddenness, the inaccessibility of God. It is this veil that separates the holiest from the holy place. And to enter into the holiest, that is the holy of holies, we have to pass through the veil. But this veil, separating man from God's intimate presence, is forever opened. Why? Being torn into two from top to bottom. And what does it indicate? Indicating a symbolic way on earth, that the way of access to God in heaven, it was opened now by Christ's death. Let me elaborate the words. Elaborate using the words of this theologian, Charles Spurgeon, and I quote, "For believers, the veil is not rolled up, but rent. The veil was not unhooked and carefully folded up and put away, so that it might be put in its place at some time, some future time. Oh no, but the divine hand took it and rent it front, top to bottom. It can never be hung up again. It can never be hung up again. That is impossible. Between those who are in Christ Jesus and the great God, there will never again, never be another separation." Yes, between those who are in Christ Jesus and the great God, there will never be another separation. Unquote. Now, friends, this is what Jesus had done, and this is what we can have confidence in Christ. And thirdly, Jesus, he is the great priest over the house of God. How is it so? So under the old covenant, the high priest, he had access because of the blood of an animal. Now, under the new covenant, Jesus, the perfect sacrifice who opened a new and living way, he ushers us into the throne, into the throne room of God and the house of God, over which he exercises his high priesthood, is none other but the community of God's people, and that includes you and me. So what can we say? Being a truly divine high priest, the act of Christ, it was just perfect once for all and of eternal value. Jesus, friends, Jesus, he has opened for us the way of access to God, such that we can continually draw near to God, into his presence, without fear and with confidence. Eugene Peterson, he mentioned this in his message. We can now, without hesitation, walk right up to God into the holy place. Jesus has cleared the way by the blood of his sacrifice, acting as our priest before God. So friends, having said all this, we talk about gathering in the beginning. So what has all this got to do with our gathering together that we are talking about? Friends, all that God wants from us is to love the Lord, the God, with all our hearts, our minds, and our souls. And Jesus, he continued, that you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You see, God himself gave us his love to enable us to love one another. The primary focus of gathering is that if we are serious about loving God, we must be serious about loving other people too. Loving the people around us, loving the people in our homes. We love because God first loved us. And God's love, it is reflected in our love for others. And because of that, we can have confidence in God. So how then should we live in the light of the superiority of Christ and all his work in his covenant? Hebrews continue in chapter 10, verses 22 to 24. It says, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. So there are three main points here. Allow me to share with you. Firstly, in light of what Jesus did, we are to draw near to God. You see, God doesn't want us to just know facts about him. Knowing is not enough. He wants us to know. He wants us to recognize the intentions of his heart so that we will draw near to him. So with our hearts sprinkled clean, which shows the perfect cleansing is now available to us. In the Christian practice of baptism, that is the bodies being washed, we can draw near to God in a way never available to someone under the old covenant. The works of Jesus, it makes us able to draw near in full assurance of faith, in that the problem of access to God, well, it has been settled. The problem of the perfect high priest, it has been settled too. And the problem of our moral and spiritual pollution has been settled. Friends, you and I, we are not worthy, but we have been made worthy, and we have been made clean. Yet, why do we still find it so difficult to draw near to God? Do you have such difficulty? Do you have such a struggle? Friends, Christ's work is absolutely, positively, completely sufficient. We fail to draw near to God because the truth of the matter is that our relationship with God is just not on track. We should live and go on because of the finished work of Christ and not on our own presumptions. Secondly, in light of what Jesus did, we are to hold fast to the truth. Well, basically that means holding fast the confession of our hope with an unwavering fidelity to the eschatological hope that Christians, all of us, Christians, believers, possess through Christ. So what is this confession? It is a confession of our firm, fixed, steadfast confidence in this gift of salvation that God has extended to the community on the basis of Christ's priesthood and sacrifice. Now, friends, the confession of our hope is not just being hopeful, but it is to hope with this confident expectation. So when we gather together in Christ, we allow the community to affirm our privileged status as the people who have been granted access to God through Christ. Well, there may be discouragement sometimes. You see, sometimes this discouragement, it often makes us waver from the truth. And suffering is just so real, right? But friends, a renewed confidence in the greatness of Jesus and in the new covenant will make us stand strong in the faith. And in addition, the reason we can stand strong is because he who promised is faithful. Indeed, God will keep his promises, not because of anything we do, but because of his faithfulness. Friends, it is therefore surely far better to trust in God's faithfulness instead of ours. And thirdly, in light of what Jesus did, we are to consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. But what does that mean? Basically, it means to pursue the community of the people of God. To pursue the community of the people of God. Here, the exhortation really centers on our Christian responsibility to exhibit practical concern for one another. So as a community here in SKMC, we keep in touch and we stay connected with one another to various means, right? Whether it is during the COVID or not. How do we keep in touch? Through small groups, ourselves, through informal gatherings. You know, good works, these are tangible expressions of caring love. Active support and concern for the welfare of one another. These are matters of critical urgency in the life of a community exposed so frequently to testing, to disappointments. In fact, often discouragement and disappointment, it makes us avoid community at the very time that we needed it most. Yet, the scripture tells us that gather together, it strengthens us in a time of difficulty, darkness, discouragement, disappointments. Friends, how do you deal with doubt, uncertainty in your life? Well, the scripture teaches us uncertainty may be remedied by gaining assurance from God's word, by remembering God's past goodness, by reflecting on God's power, and by appealing to God's unfailing love. Surely, one who is facing doubts and uncertainty, how could he find remedy himself or herself? That's why we need to gather together in Christ. How do we stir up one another to love and good works? How do we help the weak with patience and encouragement that reflects God's own compassion? How can we do that? So scripture teaches us some examples. Give us some examples, perhaps. Pray for one another. Encourage one another. Build one another up. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. To exhort one another every day. To love one another with brotherly affection. To be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. To love and serve one another. To instruct one another. Wow, that's a long list, right? Is it even achievable? Well, friends, these are words of our Lord Jesus and Apostle Paul. In fact, for Apostle Paul, who is the author of 13 epistles in the New Testament, he never kept for himself what he received from God. In fact, what he received from God above, he expressed it across in the communities that he visited. It is true that COVID has changed our lifestyle and probably the pace that we work. I know that numerous cell groups are still meeting online, but we keep in touch and we connect with one another in all these various ways, through phone calls, video calls, text messages. These are just available for us, isn't it? So I remember vividly when our country was fighting very fiercely against the virus. My mother-in-law was not spared as she lay in critical condition in the ICU. We were not allowed to see her. So during her last moments, the hospital arranged a Zoom session for us so that we could see her in the ICU. Now, gathering together physically is ideal, but it was just not possible then. There was no hugs, but we could only stare at the screen. But friends, that's not the point of this whole sharing. It was just this greatest awakening that we should treasure the time together whenever and whoever that we meet, or whoever that we gather together, especially in Christ. Watching over one another in love is really to be internalized and expressed in our daily lives. Now, friends, after almost 3 years, today we desire to meet face to face, right? Don't we especially desire to gather together in Christ, to see that smile, to shake that hand, to pat that shoulder, to say high five? We desire to see a friend face to face, to ask, how have you been, my friend? So whether physical or online gathering, friends, do you still find gathering too daunting? Or do you find it difficult to even get started? Perhaps we should clarify that to get together, it does not mean that you have to be 24/7 constantly in a group meeting. It does not mean that you agree with all the disagreements or conflicts. Neither does it mean that you must consent to everything and anything that you don't want to. And most importantly, it does not mean to judge one another. Then, what is to get the together in Christ? Is there, you know, we are so used to this, is there a model or some sample that we can reference to? Is there this biblical gathering model that we can reference to? Well, I mentioned earlier in my sermon that to gather together is to come together and form a group or to meet together as a group in one place. But it goes beyond that. So since we have confidence in Christ for what Jesus had done for us, to be gathered together in Christ is therefore our commitment to God. What do I mean? Now, there are various commitments in our life. I believe all of us understand that. Commitment to our family, our friends, our church. If you are an employer, you have commitment to your employees. Teachers, you have commitment to the school, to the students, to the parents, and many, many more commitments. But the Bible teaches that the chief commitment of our lives is to God Himself. That is, every part of our lives must be committed to loving and serving God. Now, the pulpit theme for this month of January is on commitment and dedication. So in the last few weeks, we saw the dedication of leaders, co-workers, who so willingly, so faithfully stepped forward to serve the community in SKMC. We also commit to pledge our service and the first fruits of our labor for the advancement of God's kingdom. So our commitment to God is to draw near to God, to hold fast to the truth, to stir up one another to love and good works. I thank God. I thank God that we have many new friends every week. In fact, since I joined, this is the third week, right? Every week there are newcomers. The list is just so long. I thank God for that. Church, as regular worshippers, as members of the church, would you welcome our friends, our newcomers, so that they experience joy, they experience the joy, the peace with one another here in SKMC. Friends, a commitment to God, it also means a commitment to God's people. The community of faith here in SKMC needs to be nourished, needs to be supported by the church, and to work towards its edification. So since we have confidence in Christ for what Jesus had done for us, our commitment to God and His people, this is basically expressed in mutual responsibility and concern when we as a community is gathered together in Christ. Hebrews 10:25, it continues, not neglecting to meet together as it is a habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Friends, the church is one essence because it is found on one gospel, united to one Lord and indwelled by one Spirit. Its unity is under constant threat because of the tendency of division that is inherent in this fallen humanity and needs to be continually, therefore, maintained and actively expressed. In which way? In fellowship. How is fellowship possible? Fellowship is expressed by gathering together. A Christian community is designed to be gathered together. Friends, coming together is not just about occupying a seat or coming to a place. We gather together, it's not just for fun, but we gather because we are grateful for God's incredible work of salvation. Our motivation to gather together, it must be to consider one another. It must be to edify one another in provoking one another to love and good works as we obey God's commands together. And it must be to give to one another. And from Ecclesiastes 4, when we gather together, we are required to be helpful and to be a support to each other. So because it is so important that believers gather together, anything that works against the gathering must be regarded as serious dangers. Serious dangers. What could they be? Division in the group, intolerable persecution, even apostasy, the abandonment and renunciation of our belief. Therefore, church, we must work towards standing firm in one spirit, with our mind, one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel, that together, in one voice, we may glorify God. I used to belong to a small group many, many years ago, but only on paper. Some of us are also like that, right? Why? Because I felt traveling was too time-consuming. Because I worked late most of the time. Because I felt I could not fit in. Because I just could not finish the readings that were being assigned. So I skipped the small groups, meetings. And I realized, and I learned, the seriousness of neglecting communal gatherings and meetings, the hard way. I drifted away from God. I lost a communal setting where mutual encouragement, teaching, correction, and even rebuke may occur. I failed to appreciate the significance of Christ's priestly ministry and the access to God that it provided. I was in the wilderness for many, many years. I lost precious time with the community of faith that could help me persevere in my faith. Friends, how about you? How about you? When we gather together in Christ, it is for both our personal spiritual growth as well as the spiritual formation of everyone in the group. It is not how often we meet. It is, do you meet? Do you gather together in Christ? How urgent is it to be involved in the life of a community then? Today's passage reminds that the day of the Lord is drawing near. Although we do not know when that will be, we must be ready when the time comes, as the day of Jesus' return draws nearer. We should be more committed to the fellowship of God's people, the gathering of ourselves together in Christ. Friends, it is crucial to gather together. So if we have not started gathering together, would you start now, today, from today? How do you start? By encouraging one another. Are you generous with affirmation? Are you generous with your encouragement to one another? To your family members, to your friends, even to a fellow worshipper, a fellow member here in the 845 congregation? Would you, when the service is over, as you walk out of the sanctuary, would you pat somebody's shoulder and said a word of encouragement to that person? Would you gather together in Christ, not only on Sundays, not only on special festivals or occasions like the Easter and Christmas, that then I get to see you, but weekly in your small groups? Whether it is a phone call, or is it meeting together? Friends, as we live with hope of our future heavenly reward, let us motivate one another to be a community gathered together always in Christ, whether physically or online, to build up the church, the people of God, on the one foundation, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you, Jesus, for what you have done for us. And because of this truth, we know that it is not just a task, but it is really necessary for us to gather together in Christ. For it is meaningful. For it helps us to keep our focus on you. For it draws us closer to you, Almighty God. Yes, Almighty God. May you lead us, grant us your wisdom so that we could build our life upon your love And may you guide us so that we may build up someone who we so often tend to overlook. Yes, teach us to be generous with our encouragement for one another. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and good works. Let us today, starting from today, invite those whom we have missed for so long to come gather together in Christ. Not for ourselves, but all for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray all this. Amen. Church.